generation learned right from wrong, good from evil, the ethical and moral thing to do from comic books.
The origin of Batman starts with alienation and acceptance themes. It's the idea of a kid being orphaned by crime.
It's operatic, it's huge. It's, you know, somebody on their knees crying over their dead parents.
He's spent a good portion of his life honing himself to physical, psychological perfection.
I like Batman for a couple of reasons. First obvious one is that he's got a cape. Capes are really fun to draw. They look really cool. Mostly I like him because he's really angry.
The fact that you can mention Joker and Riddler and Two-Face and Penguin and Catwoman, it's such a steady stream. They're all characters that can almost exist unto themselves.
You can show people that the icon of the bat symbol in any country, in any language, and they'll look at it and they'll tell you it's Batman.
The thing I love most about working in comics is that it's a legacy. Everybody's really lucky to be a part of that character.
Rising from the depths of tragedy, he has sworn to fight the forces of evil. He is the Batman, one of the most popular and iconic figures in literary history. But the journey that the Dark Knight detective has taken to become a worldwide phenomenon is filled with almost as many twists, turns, and close calls as one of his cases. The story starts in the 1930s. As the United States was facing the ever-growing threat of war, people were looking for a way to escape their everyday troubles. The young, rapidly growing comic book industry supplied the escapism they craved.
There are really only four or five Native American art forms. The banjo is one, musical comedy as we know it today, the mystery story as started by Edgar Allan Poe, the comic book which we started, and jazz. Those are the five. It is a native art form that appeals to our sense and understanding of mixed media. Comic book is the perfect art form. It's got everything but ballet in it.
The comics as we know them in America, I mean, really, in a sense, sort of evolved out of, you know, the great comic strips, the newspapers. I mean, that was like what you wanted. If you're a comic artist, you wanted to work on newspapers. The comic book themselves sort of came out of the idea of taking newspaper comic strips and essentially putting them in a cover, you know, stapling them together and selling them. The superhero comics were coming in with the war. And so I think these fantasy images are projections of, well, how do you deal in these tumultuous times? So by the time, you know, America gets involved in the war in 1941 after December 7th when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, then America's finally committed and they're in, and the comic book world is committed too.
DC Comics had quite a success with the mighty Superman, and they found themselves looking for more colorful characters to fill their pages. But was this new kind of superhero just a flash in the pan? The answer was locked in the imagination of a young man named Robert Kane.
Bob Kane was a kid when he created Batman. He was really just a teenager. And it was the late 1930s. The comic book industry was brand new, but he had an interesting assignment. DC Comics was looking for a complement to the first superhero that they had presented, which was Superman. And to Bob, what made the most sense would be to go in the opposite direction and create a character who could be a superhero, but really based in humanity.
I saw a book by Leonardo da Vinci, and he had all his early inventions in the book. There was one drawing of a man on a bat sled. He had huge bat wings, and he was on a sled. It was the first glider into space. And to me, it looked like a bat. And actually, he had a quote, "Your model shall have no other wings but that of a bat." And then basically I saw Zorro, the dual identity of Zorro, with Doug Fairbanks Sr., who was my idol as a kid. At night he fought the desperados in the old Spanish West as Zorro with the mask. And he came out of a cave with a dark horse, a black horse called Tornado, and instead I reinterpreted and made a Batmobile.
As far as the other influences, a lot of them came from previous pop culture things that Kane had absorbed when he was a kid. The Shadow was a very popular radio character who was mysterious and wore dark clothes and was a creature of the night and fought crime.
Batman is closer to the pulp magazine roots than most characters that were in comics. I mean, I think a lot of the comic book archetypes came out of the pulp magazines. Some of them were really violent and really scary, and I think Batman really kept one foot in that world.
I thought the name was good. It's a good name, Batman. When I saw the drawings of him, he looked like a very mysterious figure with that cape or whatever it was wrapped around him.
Bob Kane, Bruce Wayne, Batman are really all one and the same, and the character is really simply an extension of Bob Kane and who Bob Kane was and what he was about and so forth. He said as a child his dream was to live in a castle in Italy and have a butler. And where does Bruce Wayne live? He lives in a mansion, which is close to a castle, and he has Alfred. So I think a lot of his daydreams and things as a child were just incorporated into the character.
I'm really sorry he isn't around today, because he always used to say, "Hey, you see, Batman, it was the biggest movie of the year. Where's Spider-Man?" You know, there's nothing I could say. Finally, Spider-Man gets on the screen, and where's Bob? Terrible.
Kane quickly realized that he had a success on his hands, and keeping up with the demand for the Dark Knight's adventures would be more than just a one-man job. Soon he hired a handful of collaborators to help bring the Caped Crusader to life. Men such as Bill Finger, Jerry Robinson, Dick Sprang, and Gardner Fox would in the coming years help the growing legend of the Batman reach heights that even the optimistic Bob Kane couldn't have thought possible.
Batman has always had some of the greatest writers, artists, and editors working on his adventures at DC Comics, really from its inception. Bill Finger was one of the comic book kingdom's great writers. This was a guy who had a fertile imagination, who wasn't afraid to go out and do research to bring interesting tidbits to his stories.
Arguably, Bill understood how to write comics better than anyone back then. It was a brand new medium. Comic books up until Superman had been reprints of comic strips.
Gardner Fox was another important Batman writer. Not only of that era, but he was still writing Batman adventures well into the 60s.
Questions of creativity don't come into it. When you're doing a character like that, it belongs to who it belongs to. And the people who help make it only add to the luster.
As the world of Batman was growing and evolving, many of these early adventures laid the foundation for a character who would last for decades upon decades. This Batman was truly a dark Avenger who was fearless and sometimes ruthless. He was a playboy by day and a detective by night, fighting to help right the wrongs in what would become Gotham City.
The kid has his parents taken away from him by crime. And then he vows vengeance on the guys who did this. And then he disappears. And we know that he's been training for 10 some odd years, perfecting his mind, perfecting his body. And then he shows up back in Gotham City, ready to carry out his mission. And that mission, he appears as Batman. And we don't get much filled in between the time his parents were shot and he emerges in the Batsuit. That was the way it was in 1939 in the original origin of Batman.
I like the fact that he implies a world that needs a hero, where so many of these characters just seem like these reassuring, glowing figures. Batman's the guy that you want to have, you know, at your back in a dark alley. Doesn't mean you have to have dinner with him.
As the Batman continued to wreak havoc on the criminal underworld, it quickly became apparent that petty crooks and low-level thugs were no match for this dark Avenger of the night. Soon, Batman was defending the good citizens of Gotham from a wide array of colorful but dangerous villains, many of which became classic characters in their own right. Bob Kane had tapped into something big, and now the creative well was overflowing.
In the first issue of Batman Comics, spring 1940, two characters were introduced, the Joker and the Catwoman. And it's really a seminal issue, and you talk about a great first issue comic, that's it.
The Joker, I would submit, is the best trickster character ever, and a perfect villain for Batman, who for all the fact that he lurks in a costume, represents the triumph of rationality.
I mean, hands down, my favorite villain has to be the Joker. Like, he's the dude that something bad happened to him, and he's like, well, the way I deal with my grief is by making sure that everyone experiences grief so that he fits in a bit more. So, great. It's a great yin to the yang of Batman. It's been a really great creation.
I always felt that if the Joker as a character was bisected, and one part of him was the vicious killer, and one part was the over-the-top comedian, you would have Two-Face on the one hand and the Riddler on the other.
Any character, any villain exploits a hero's weakness is great. Any character that helps accentuate, makes the character powerful is also great. The fact that the Riddler is out there with these in-depth questions that are always being asked that Batman has to figure out in order to solve the crime, that shows the detective side of Batman, the thinking side of Batman. It's not just about brute force or all the fancy gadgets.
The cool cigarette pack had a penguin on it, and at that time I smoked, and when I was trying to create some supervillains, I said, oh my gosh, this looks like a little fat man in a tuxedo, and why not call him a penguin? We'll make him a villain. It was as simple as that, the cool cigarette thing and the penguin.
The entire rogues gallery is always interestingly parallel to him because they're not much different than Batman. The only difference is Batman does the right thing and these dudes are just all about doing the wrong thing, but they all have tragic backstories. Nobody ever just goes like, I'm going to become a criminal. You know, there is something bad happens to them that spins them off into this direction, just as something bad happened to Bruce Wayne to spin him off into the direction of Batman.
As it was with his enemies, Batman's supporting cast of allies quickly became a big part of his rapidly growing legend. For a character who began as a lone figure in the night, Batman found himself with friends and, perhaps more importantly, his own sense of family.
Even compared to Superman, Batman has a much broader sense of family, I guess, because you have Batman, you have Robin, you have Catwoman, you've got Nightwing. If you want to leak over, you got Justice League of America, Batman's in that, Teen Titans, Robin's in that.
In the comic books, Robin was a seminal character because he was really the first kid sidekick. And pretty soon, almost everyone was getting a kid sidekick.
I think when Bruce looks at Robin, he sees a young man of tremendous potential who can do much to help the common good. But I think also he sees somebody who could be, not left to his own devices, who could be a potential threat and somebody he might have to face, you know, as an adversary someday. So isn't it better that I take this young man and guide him and teach him how to marshal and hone his great skills and use him as a force for good rather than leave an angry, bitter young man, you know, of great physical power out there on the streets on his own?
When I first got to tell the story of Robin, I wanted a situation and where he would see in this child an opportunity to make the things right that were wrong in his own life.
Yeah, the character of Jim Gordon is crucial, essential to the Batman mythos. He's one of Batman / Bruce Wayne's only friends.
Commissioner Gordon, or Captain Gordon, I liked him being a captain, so he was up against the bad guys as much as Batman. And Robin and Alfred all have their antecedents. The main thing that is surprising in a way is that Batman's never really had, there's never really been a mature woman who matches him and is part of his team. Catwoman seems to fall neatly into that, but it never quite works out that way in the comics or the movies.
I know, just as a technical thing, when you're writing a character like Batman, it's kind of good to have somebody to talk to, just to get information out. Well, we're going to do this, rather than just doing it. You know, Alfred just takes care of all that stuff.
Originally, in the comic books, he was Alfred Beagle, a heavyset gentleman from England who all he wanted to do was be an amateur detective. Eventually, he lost a lot of weight and turned into Alfred Pennyworth, the trusted butler that we all have come to know and love.
Since Batman is in the cave brooding on his, you know, his dead parents, and, you know, he needs somebody to pay the electric bills. I mean, just a guy to run things. And he has no idea who, you know, how the phone bill is getting paid. You know, Alfred just takes care of all that stuff.
The Joker and Catwoman and Robin, I mean, that so much of that still exists today. And being someone who has created new characters and has looked through what stuck in the last even 20 years, and there's so little that has, there really isn't a whole lot more that certainly has had the kind of impact that those characters did, that you think that those characters could be still here 10 years from now.
Batman had become something of a sensation. Soon he and Robin were everywhere. From out of the comic books, they jumped into newspaper strips, the radio, movie screens, and could even be seen helping out with the war effort.
When you look at the 1940s, he's dealing with the war. He's dealing with the idea of spies in America, the ideas of rampant crime because of the whole issue of the growing organized crime world.
There were two serials in the 1940s, and Batman started to appear on the Superman radio show. So we had the emergence of Batman as radio star for a while on Superman's adventures.
My favorite live-action version of Batman is probably from the old movie serials. He wasn't awfully high-tech, but he was just this guy out doing a lot of hard work. But he was cool, and he didn't have polish upon polish upon polish.
Not the most expensive productions in the world, let's say, but the original one in the early 40s, they went in with good intentions, chance to do a darker version of Batman, and I think considering it was just a movie serial, which of course were 12 to 15 minute chapters that would run every Saturday at the movie theater and end with a cliffhanging ending, so kids in particular would be tempted to come back to the movies next Saturday to see how Batman escapes from one doom or one trap or another.
By the 1950s, Batman's popularity had reached dizzying heights. But in 1954, a book was published that caused such a shockwave that congressional hearings were held. The young comic book industry was under attack, and it was rocked to the core.
Well, one day a psychiatrist named Frederick Wortham wrote a book called Seduction of the Innocent, which purported to prove that comic books were responsible for every ill that man and flesh are heir to. And unfortunately, a lot of people read the book, and a lot of people were taken in by what he said.
Just about every superhero got taken over the coals by Dr. Wortham.
I mean, he said things like 90% of all the kids in reform school read comics. Of course, 90% of them also drank milk, but that didn't matter to him.
He seemed to feel that comic books were the root cause of the post-war rise in juvenile delinquency in the country. He even went so far as to claim that comic books caused asthma because children were staying inside to read instead of being outside and playing in the fresh air.
For a while, it really hurt the comic book industry. So a lot of the publishers who were publishing so-called horror magazines dropped the books and so forth. And because of that, a new organization was formed called the Comic Magazine Association of America, and they were like a self-censorship body. All of the comics publishers would send the strips to them to be approved before they would go to the printer to make sure nothing would offend anybody in our comic books.
As a result, a lot of the writers and artists of the era and following that claim they felt very restricted creatively in terms of what they could do. And a lot of people see the 50s as kind of a bland era for comic books, kind of like the Eisenhower era of comic books.
I think in the 50s he was a solid citizen. He was Gotham City's leading citizen. He would walk down the street, and, you know, he'd participate in civic contests and things like that.
Comics had to find a way to survive, and Batman was no exception. As a result, Batman and Robin's adventures started to lean more toward the fantastic. The popular science fiction trend found its way into the Batcave with just a touch of zaniness thrown in for good measure. Unfortunately, this lighter fare and the addition of an expanded Bat family proved to be temporary fixes for what was becoming a growing problem. Many readers were losing interest.
Batman in the 60s could really be divided into two eras, pre-1964 and 1964 post. Pre-1964, it was pretty much the same as it was in the 50s. Way too many aliens. And then everything changed. the sales of Batman really had gone down. DC Comics was seriously considering canceling Detective Comics. Something had to be done. So the executives turned to their best editor, Julius Schwartz.
Julie reinvented everything. Julie brought back the Flash, she brought back the Atom, and the Hawkman, and the Spectre, and the Justice League. And he reinvented the Batman.
He took one of his most popular artists, Carmine Infantino, and put him on Batman to give it what was considered at the time a much more realistic look to the draftsmanship.
Julie's the one who helped institute the new look for Batman. He was able to really take all the excitement that was happening at the time with Batman and television and really find a way to transfer it to the comics themselves and bring that same level of energy without feeling the characters being degraded or made fun of or being played for laughs. So he found a way to make the mystery aspect back into it.
He also brought along more artists and more writers than anybody ever has in comics. He really was the new godfather of the modern comic book.
They turned Batman really on its head. All of a sudden, the symbol, the Black Bat, now had a yellow circle around it. And it was these comics in particular that inspired Bill Dozier to do the TV show.
The Batman TV show is a wonderful addition to the history of Batman by how popular it made it throughout the world. It wasn't necessarily the truest representation of what comic fans love about Batman because it itself wasn't taking itself seriously. It didn't really matter. It ultimately added to our history and why we still know Batman today.
It was a perfectly viable way to do a comedy show. They did it for about, it was popular for 2 years. It limped into a third year, and then, like somebody turning on a light, the camp fad was over. But when the camp fad was over, the comic books weren't.
As the 60s bore on and there was more of a maturity waking up in our popular entertainment forms, an audience that was getting older, a teenage audience, demanded more of their Batman than what they had been enjoying in the 40s and 50s with the mostly Bob Kane style of cartooning and the sort of farcical adventures that Batman and Robin would get into.
So the artist Neil Adams and I were the new kids on the block. We were sort of the flavor of the week. What we did was sort of what we thought had been done in 1939, which was to try and put some psychological validity into the character, or rather just to emphasize what was already implicit. He is alone, he is obsessed with catching crime, he uses the Batman persona as a tool to that end.
Denny O'Neill, for me, is the guy who has defined Batman as he exists today. He's the one who was able to take him through so many years, through so many incarnations, and be able to keep his own set of rules and beliefs on who Batman is.
Neil is not a cartoonist so much as an illustrator. He has great regard for the way things really look. But because of the nature of the fantasy melodrama we do, there are these elements of the fantastic, which he tries to make as realistic as somebody's front porch.
As quickly as the latest wave of Batmania had washed over the pop culture landscape, it had receded. In its wake, Neil Adams and Denny O'Neill, led by Julie Schwartz, had redefined Batman for a new generation. The Dark Knight Detective was back in a big way.
Under the pen of some great artists like Neil Adams, Marshall Rogers, Steve Englehart, who was a great writer at the time, really brought something very, very fresh and new to a audience of comic book fans who were starved.
We start to enter into a period of level social relevance in the 70s, and Batman becomes relevant. He's starting to deal with social issues and things there are. One of the most poignant, strongest comics I ever read with Batman had to deal with a Nazi war criminal. And him hunting him down or coming across him, and the fact that he's killing people of Jewish descent, and Batman has to deal with this issue. Very strong, powerful storytelling. Not something that would ever have been told in the 40s, but really worked well for the period of time in the 70s when it was presented.
It was a good time for the Batman comic books, as he really once again found himself as a solo hero and really redefined his mission.
As Batman was reestablishing himself, so too was his supporting cast. Robin and Batgirl had grown up and moved on to their own adventures. But the Boy Wonder wasn't the only one who was getting older. So were his fans. Comic books were no longer just for kids.
Comics in the early 80s were reaching an older and older audience and were providing the opportunity for the creative people to take chances and challenges they hadn't taken before.
In the 80s, I grew up with Frank Miller. When Frank Miller came in there and completely, you know, revitalized the Dark Knight once again for a new decade.
He kind of brought Batman back to his darker roots and something more in line with the original vision of the character. And from that point forward, that's the Batman that we wanted to see, and then that's the Batman that Tim Burton gave us in 1989.
Both times I visited Batman with Dark Knight, I was looking to bring him into whatever era it was. It doesn't mean you have to change the essence of the character, it's just that you should pay attention to the times you live in. And in the 80s, when I did the first Dark Knight, I felt the character had taken on an irrelevance because the world he inhabited was a very safe place. And so dressing up like a bat and hunting down criminals and savagely beating them seemed a bit extreme in the nice world of Gotham City. And so I looked around for something that would justify a character as severe as Batman needed to be, and as he had once been. All I really had to do was look out my window. The 80s were a scary time, I mean, and as are these days.
He said, well, we'll just put them at odds with each other. Putting them at odds is a great idea. When they're friends, you don't have a lot of friction going on there.
In the fantasy of a superhero, he takes on the notion of being either a father figure or an avenger. And someone who's bringing order to a chaotic world. I think that there has been an attempt to bring a superficial reality to superheroes that's ultimately rather stupid. That they work best as the flamboyant fantasies they are. I mean, these are characters who are broad and big. I don't really need to see sweat patches under Superman's arms. I want to see him fly.
With the success of The Dark Knight Returns, Batman had once again hit the mainstream. Miller revitalized Batman's world again in the 80s with his groundbreaking tale of the Caped Crusaders' early years, Batman Year One. The comics were alive, full of creativity, and as popular as they'd ever been. But one of the more controversial moves to come out of the 1980s simply started out as an exercise in audience involvement.
What if we could have the audience participate? What if we could have them call in and influence the story? That evolved into what became known around here as the telephone stunt. Dick Grayson had graduated up to being Nightwing, and there was a second Robin put on stage, Jason Todd. To use an old-fashioned word, he became kind of a snot.
If you talk back to Batman, which Jason Todd did, they're going to vote to kill you.
He is in an explosion set by the Joker. And then the story ends. Did he live or did he die? Well, our readers had 3 days. If they called 1-800 number, he survived. If they called another 800 number, he did not survive.
I drew the cover, which was Robin laying there in a pile of broken wood with blood. It was really nasty. There was blood all over him. And people thought, well, you know, you've drawn the cover of him dead. You know, and we haven't got the votes yet. I said, well, it's not necessarily dead. His head's still on his body. It's just, he might just be badly hurt.
We put the he doesn't make it ending into the process, and off we went. I was not prepared for the fallout.
It never even occurred to me this would be some big deal. But I remember it was the first piece of, maybe the only piece of art of mine that ever appeared in Newsweek.
A Death in the Family was just one of the many landmark stories to come out of the 80s. Writers and artists were stretching themselves in bold new directions and diving headfirst into the dark corners of Batman's world in graphic novels such as Arkham Asylum and The Killing Joke, a new look at a classic tale.
I was a huge fan of The Killing Joke, which is a story that Alan Moore had written and Brian Bolan had drawn. That kind of is more of a Joker story than a Batman story. But at the end, Batman kind of gets to laugh a little bit, which I was charmed by.
Killing Joke is, it's such a nice, straightforward story, but it's probably one of the most, in my mind, one of the most brilliant stories there's been told in mainstream superhero comics.
I wanted it to be very much about the Joker because he was
to me, such a fascinating character. Batman, if anything, is more of a shadow. He almost works best when he's a two-dimensional character. To me, Joker is somehow a much more rounded character. He's an enigma completely, because he is very much the way a lot of us on some level are. Well, it's well written. It's, you know, Alan does have the ability to take a lot of the characters and just take, you know, and just know what people really would like. I mean, he's not pandering to commercial taste, but he knows what's good about the characters.
These books were redefining the character for a new age, and the seriousness of these graphic novels changed the entire industry. So in a way, we needed a calling card to sort of wave out there to the rest of the public that, like, hey, we're cool, check us out. And I think that in many ways, the Batman movie was the biggest arm of that.
Actually, I do remember when we started work on the Batman movie that Tim Burton would go to meetings to try to get potential licensees excited, and he would hold up Killing Joke and he would say, this is what I want the movie to look like.
The next wave of Batmania that had been building exploded in the summer of 1989 when Batman made it back to the big screen. The film took its cue from the comics of the 80s. It was dark. It was sophisticated. It was the complete opposite of the television show. It was Bob Kane's creation come to life, and it was, quite simply, a phenomenon.
He felt it should not be the TV show all over again. He said that was fine for the 1960s, but we have to go back to what I originally created, and his instincts were right.
When the film hit, it was probably the most exceptional period we ever experienced in our field of connection between media on sales. We spent that summer sitting around the conference table literally every week figuring out how we could get more paper to print more books, where we were going to send more books, how many more books we could possibly print, and aren't they going to have too many now? There can't possibly be that many people in the world who want this, and there always seem to be more.
Well, clearly the film had to operate, and the script had to operate in such a way as taking in what had just been done in the comic books with Dark Knight, with Batman Year One. And even if it wasn't replicating those elements of storytelling, it had to sort of pay homage or give some credence to what was being, the ground that was being broken at the time. One of the biggest effects and most positive legacies left behind from Tim Burton's Batman films is the fact that it helped to greenlight the wonderful animated series.
As Batman was conquering the big screen, he set his eyes back on the small screen. There had been several animated versions of Batman over the years, but none of them had caused a sensation like this. Batman, the animated series, succeeded not only as a television series, but also in the way it left a lasting impact on the overall Batman mythology.
Bruce Timm was the principal architect of the look for the characters. Eric Radomski was the architect of the architecture, so to speak. He was mostly, I think, involved with the backgrounds.
We kind of took a stab at it and applied a lot of elements from a lot of different sources, and they weren't all strictly Batman or comics. They came from action films and traditional painting and different animation that we'd seen. So there were a lot of different things that we tried to bring to the table to add some unique value to our version.
If anything, we were trying to specifically carve out our own niche that didn't specifically evoke the movies, because, you know, Tim Burton's movies are great, but we wanted to do our own thing, and we wanted to make sure that our show didn't just seem like just a cheap knockoff of what he was doing in the movies. So we tried to deliberately try to find ways to separate the two visually.
Ultimately, our series did not look much like Tim Burton's version, but it was a dark vision of Batman and Gotham City, which I think the audience was primed for.
Every now and then something comes along which redefines the way that people not only look at Batman, it was the way they looked at animation. It was a look and a feel and a level of quality that hasn't yet really been challenged.
Comics exploded in the 90s, we all know that. I think, yeah, Batman, the Batman movies are a big part of that. When Batman came out, there was all these Batman books launching, all this Batman merchandise. And comics were really cool. They were right in the mainstream. They were still available at bookstores and grocery stores and 7-Elevens.
More Batman comics led to some of the Dark Knight supporting cast getting their own books. After decades as a sidekick, Robin finally got his own solo book to follow the adventures of Tim Drake, Jason Todd's replacement. The Caped Crusaders comic books of the 90s delved into the characters' minds and explored their motivations as they continued to grow and evolve.
In the innocence, when comics were born, the creators just assumed that the guy lost his parents, he got over it, but he's still out there fighting crime, having a good time, Robin's with him. They just sort of go straight on. They know there was an innocence there in terms of storytelling. You know, 60 years later or whatever, we're not innocent in terms of the way we see media. Batman is part of this era in which we kind of know a good story when we see it, and we want it in all its depth and complexity, and that's what Batman gives us.
There is something going on right now in comics. There's an excitement to go back to the form. It thrills me when I get retailer reports that say, we don't know what to do with Superman and Batman. We order 100 and we sell 100. We order 200, we sell 200. We order 500, we sell 500. You know, we don't know where the top is. We don't know where the bottom is.
After decades of adventures, countless writers and artists, and a myriad of interpretations, Batman is still standing, with a rich legacy behind him and a legion of fans all over the world waiting to see what he does next.
You know, it's not so much that the characters lend themselves to so many interpretations, but you have writers trying to come up with something new, and after a while, they say, I know, what if I change the character himself? He's always had a sense of humor. I'll change him and make him dark and brooding. Or he's always been dumb. I'll make him smart. Or he's always been smart. I'll make him dumb. Or he's always been a nice guy. I'll make him not so nice. And they only do that because how long can you keep doing the same type of stories about the same type of character without losing the interest of the readers?
You love these characters and you love the mythology, and everyone just keeps taking the mythology out, putting it back, and then people look at that, take that out, do their own spin on it, and so it becomes this big melting pot of ideas over decades.
We can't take our readers for granted. We can't take our fan base for granted. We have to understand, too, that if there's a turnover in regards to who's reading our characters, who's reading our books. And realistically, we have to be in touch on what the perceptions are of the day, what are the interests are of the day, what are they reacting to, what's happening in pop culture.
You know, there's certain natural-born warriors. And there's an aspect of Batman that is a warrior, and it's not something you do, it's who you are. And it's almost like he's his own samurai sword, tempered steel, that has this kind of amazing, almost spiritual aspect to it. He's basically made himself that tempered steel.
One of the really interesting things about the job I did and the guys who edit Superman and Wonder Woman, it's a job that has never existed before. One character in continuous publication for over 60 years, now over 65. Wow.
The theme of Batman continues to be, to me, so simple that it's universal. I am one person. I can make a difference.
Sadly, for the character of Batman, he always has to be affected or tinged by what happened to him in his childhood so that he can be the hero that we all know and love.
DC Comics is American mythology. Just like the Greeks had their heroes and gods, we have our heroes and gods, and it's Superman, Batman, and Wonder Woman, and all the other heroes of the DC Universe. And everyone knows their origins. Everyone knows why Batman became Batman. Anybody knows. My mom knows why Batman became Batman. And if she knows that, then that character's everywhere, trust me.
Batman is one of those characters that I think Bob heard a voice or something that propelled him to create this character, and using his essence, he had an essence of goodness. He was a very fair-minded, pure human being, and so is Batman.
Batman's hung around long enough that he does kind of become as important to American literature as, you know, the works of Poe. Any character that sticks around that long or has that big of an impact has to be considered part of the literary canon, not just, well, he's a comic book superhero. No, he's part of the literary canon.